Hello, good morning. Welcome to today's Lightning Talks. I'll be the first speaker, so I want to get it started so that we have time for our other speakers today. So I'll be speaking on the situation on human rights in the Philippines at the moment, especially in the digital space. So I am Micheline Rama. I'm from Dakila, Philippine Collective for Modern Heroism, a human rights organization working in the Philippines. So for those who were able to visit Manila during RightsCon about 2 years ago, you'll find that while the sort of sense of Manila hasn't changed much, there's new things that are happening in the human rights space. That's definitely catching global attention, specifically this. So I'm sure you've seen the front page of the New York Times, heard about what's going on in terms of the drug war in the Philippines. I'm sure you've heard this term, tokhang. It's a Cebuano term that is a combination of tok-tok hangyu, which means knock and request, which is a term for the police operations to snuff out different drug suspects. It's also being used to refer to the extrajudicial killings happening on the streets of the Philippines right now that you've seen on the headlines. And so in terms of the human rights situation, that seems to be the headliner, but what's going on in the internet space when it comes to that? So this is the version of tokhang that's happening right now. So there's accounts being suspended, harassment online. There's actually sort of a name for it as well, cyber tokhang. It's been used by different groups that have been behind these harassments and these takedowns. And I'll take you through some of the elements of what that looks like. So first, they have what's called extrajudicial reporting, which is a play on the extrajudicial killings. There's been operations where targeted journalists, human rights advocates, have been sort of identified, and large numbers of people have reported their profiles in order for their accounts to be taken down. And this is a big deal because, especially on Facebook, over 47 million Filipinos are on Facebook out of over 100 million in the population. That's where a lot of folks get not just news, but actual commentary. And if these human rights advocates and journalists are being taken down, then we lose voices of dissent in the conversation. So in the background, you'll actually see there's been a published list of identified Facebook pages, and not just personal pages, but also community accounts, that, and there's counters on how many times they've been reported, and these this list is being used by the groups behind these attacks to monitor who they're trying to take down. And once again, these groups are sort of loosely organized. They exist on Facebook, much like sort of the 4chan groups and all of that. There's no clear affiliation, but clearly they're there to protect the administration from criticism and to attack any of those who support any form of sort of criticism and dissent with regards to the government. There's also weaponized propaganda. We've seen this in fake news. We've seen this not just in sort of the typical aspects, but also psyops or psychological operations, where there's mass posts about supposed cyber attacks. There's sort of devices certain groups have said, oh, we're going to plant this at a protest, and what it's going to do is take all of the information from your cell phone, and we'll be able to hack you. Now, for those who have any idea on how tech works, this can't happen. This is not a possibility. But because of these reports and because of these claims, some people have been deterred from going to protests or participating in activities for fear that their accounts are going to be hacked. So these are just the examples of using sort of digital media to harass protesters and activists. And lastly, we are all familiar with this hate and violence that's happening online, specifically targeted towards women especially. There's sort of a divide between just general hate culture and hate speech. And when you say hate speech, not necessarily anything that triggers community guidelines, but you know it when you see it. And of course, and then there's the other side, which actually verges on the edge of cybercrime. In the Philippines, there's a cybercrime law that ironically digital rights advocates have fought against because of the stringent measures and punishments that it recommended. But even then, there's harassment that occurs that clearly violate this law. So what happens is that there's silence in there's a silencing effect, and also on the flip side, what can happen is that advocates and those who want to dissent revert to the same tactics being used by what they're faced against, which does not contribute to a culture of free speech and tolerance on the internet as well. This is very important to note that we can't look to the government to try to regulate this. We can't look to corporations to try to regulate the spaces sometimes, simply because a lot of them are not necessarily based in the country, or these incidents fall in the gray area of what's acceptable or not acceptable in terms of community guidelines. And I'd like to point that out because a lot of conversations have been happening at RightsCon regarding sort of hardline interventions like tech or policy or sort of business cooperation, and some of these things are simply not possible in the space in the Philippines right now, or not possible in the time frame in which we're able to sort of respond better to what's happening. So what I'd like to talk about are more of the soft interventions that we're able to do, focusing on sort of behaviors, focusing on some cultural change that we as activists can control with limited resources or no resources or not even a lot of support from sort of outside influences. So the first is simply, the term digiback is something that we've coined. It's a combination of sort of digital activists in Filipino, and there's already a network that Dakila, my organization, has been training to use digital platforms in the past for campaigning. Now we're shifting the focus on protecting digital rights activists in terms of their digital security and how their online behaviors affect the security of advocates, informants, and other members of their organization. There needs to be sort of an established quick response protocol to what happens when your account gets taken down. That's actually in the works. We've seen already what can help. Contacting Facebook is not necessarily sort of the first step to this, to be honest. It takes a while for accounts to be recovered. The first step tends to be make it as public as possible, which is ironic because your account's taken down. But we've seen that once people have people tell their friends and people tell media outlets that their accounts have been taken down because of suspicious reasons, then that tends to speed up the process. Of course, sharing best practices. What we've seen is that regardless of whatever tools that we share to our partner organizations, if they don't actually change their fundamental behaviors of how they use the digital space, there's not a lot of change that's gonna happen in terms of their protection. The next is community-defined codes of conduct. We've seen this on some private media websites and organizations, some Facebook pages, different groups, wherein they set their codes of conduct. There's a campaign by a website called Rappler. It's No Place for Hate, and that they have a zero tolerance policy for sort of hateful comments and speech in their comments section. There's other campaigns which call out or tag fake news if they're posted on a certain platform. There's certain codes of conduct in terms of what's being shared and what's being spoken. And these are sort of the quick ways to circumvent the laxity of certain community guidelines on other platforms, wherein you have to be community enforced and you have to be able to call out people when things that are being said are not truthful or unacceptable. Next, there's strategic litigation. I mentioned the cybercrime law earlier. Once again, it's sort of ironic that it's being used right now to try to protect human rights defenders from what's being happening. There's already sort of a landmark case that's been filed against a group of harassers that have threatened rape and death to a human rights advocate who's a really good friend of mine. She's filed a case, and while it's a very difficult case to litigate, the act of filing that case sets a precedent that these comments and these threats will not be tolerated. There's actually a legal impact, a legal ramification to this happening, and that's very important because once that information is out there that this behavior is illegal, it actually can be a preventive message to those who want to cause more threats. That's my 10-minute warning. And lastly, this one I'm sort of excited about, because it's more focused on everyday behaviors that not just organizations can do, but individuals. And there's a Filipino term called patol, but the closest translation I could think of is positive trolling. This happens because when you're faced with very extreme forms of speech, very extreme threats, the tendency is to silence yourself and censor yourself and not engage in that sort of behavior. But the problem with that is it creates a norm wherein hate is what you encounter every day. You either block somebody or you don't stop reading that, stop engaging, but that doesn't make it go away. So there needs to be a strategy for mitigating that. And our thoughts with that is to create sort of positive trolling, meaning if somebody posts something that's you know is fake, something offensive, something that threatens other people, you have to call it out. You have to have that uncomfortable situation. You have to have that uncomfortable conversation in order to sort of move the norm back towards a place where there's empathy, where there's actual conversations, and to make sort of people understand that when they talk about human rights issues, threaten death to human rights advocates, threaten women, that people are watching, people are going to call them out, and even if the response isn't a positive, what happens is that the bystanders and those who are simply lurkers and watch sort of these common threads unfold will know that there are people who are fighting back and may feel empowered to fight back themselves. So I'll leave you with this message. So we start where we are, we use what we have, and we do what we can in order to help fight sort of injustices, hate speech, and harassment online. And that's a principle that we use at Dakila in the Philippines, and I hope that in sharing this, you can be able to use some of these principles as well. Thank you very much, and keep in touch. I'm Mitch Altogether on everywhere, so I hope to continue the conversation online. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Matthew Stender. I am a project strategist for onlinecensorship.org, as well as a tech ethicist. I'm going to be giving this talk this morning in the latter capacity. One of the things that I'm really interested in is the not only human impact of technology, the human impact, but also what does it mean to be human in the 21st century? To me, this is like a question that is quite provocative. And what are our expectations of the technology that increasingly surrounds us? So today, I'm going to be speaking about some thoughts that I have on image capture systems, and particularly facial recognition systems. I'm honored to be here with co-panelists or co-lightning talkers, working in diverse environments. I think it's particularly cool is I have a lot of people at a lot of the conferences that many of us may attend that are working mostly in a US setting or a European setting, but in the conversations around emerging technologies, a lot of the world gets forgotten about. And I don't know, Myanmar and the Philippines, I mean, both large countries with diverse histories, different ethnicities and religions and cultures. And so even inside of one place, we have the push and pull of governance and regulation and rights. But who's watching us? And I think that as we continue to develop technologies that are exported to countries, first governments are creating, are increasing their capacity to surveil their citizens. But also there's technologies being exported not just for control and surveillance, but also to be more active. I can say that this is actually technology being implemented to impact our agency and impact and codify our identity. What I mean by this is I see a world in the very not so far future in which walking down the street, whether in New York or in Manila, Mandalay, wherever it may be, that we are surrounded by not just the CCTV cameras that we're used to, but also privatized image capture systems. We've seen some demo videos of Amazon drones. Also now there's self-driving cars being tested in California. So what does it mean when we have these different pieces of a puzzle, when we have drones with sensors and cameras flying overhead, cars in the streets, we have Facebook on people's phones and one of the backgrounds of selfies, and Apple and Android both with their hardware and phones also being able to be gatekeepers of the information, of the optical information flow. I don't know exactly what it means, but I am a bit worried about it. And here's why. As humans, when it comes to our relationship with a state, in most contexts, there is a way for us to appeal to decisions. If I feel I've been harmed, maybe I can file a complaint with the Ministry of Justice. If I've been, the state system has, in many cases, a feedback mechanism for us, for its citizens, to petition the government on behalf of some sort of wrongdoing. Well, when it comes to corporations, we don't have that luxury always. And in particular, the same action, let's say us walking down the street, giving someone a high five on the street that we see, this is soon going to be captured by multiple different corporate actors. And I think that we're really at a time in human history in which that it's up to us to decide what are the shared values that we expect from our technology, and also the privacy that we expect. If I'm captured by Facebook, Google, Amazon, Apple, and Uber simultaneously, how am I to appeal my image being in their database? Am I to email each of the companies? And so I think that one of the problems right now is there's so much image collection going on, but we have not created mechanisms to have people, empower people that might be inadvertently filmed or photographed, a way to A, know that their images exist inside of databases, and secondly, to do something about that. It's what I call a distributed governance framework of facial recognition. And in some places, it may not be so harmful, but if one day a technology company operating in Myanmar or Philippines or India now, where governments are working to also bring together biometric databases and put databases on top of databases, we don't know the longevity of our images inside of these systems as well. And in countries that have even progressive, we can say, democratic oversight, there's still not formalized processes, or if there are some processes, I think that they're not strong enough. So as we're training our machines to not only film us, but also use neural networks and other machine learning processes to also identify us, I think that we need to be careful to realize that these images don't go away, that they're going to be continuously churned by these neural networks, and what our image represented to this database last week is not necessarily what it's going to mean to the database next week. And so there's a dynamic process going on in the back ends of these technologies, and we are locked out of them. We don't have access to them. We don't even know to what degree, that technology, that a company will acquire another company and they'll be able to have perhaps location data and be able to match up location data from a telephone service provider matched with, the image recognition system they have, and maybe now they're able to paint a story about us that they weren't with just their one database. So I think that as we're going forward, we need to realize that every time we're captured by a system and it's stored on a server somewhere, it's not necessarily just going to stay there. And just what it means in that instance of capture is not necessarily what it's going to mean in a year's time. And so I think that what this comes down to is these are also not neutral technologies. Many of these technologies are being built to increase ad revenue, right? We're teaching machines to be capitalists. In other places, in countries like China, where Baidu and Tencent are making large advances in AI, there's also an element of social control. And so we're now in this place in which we have a Silicon Valley creating capitalist machines and perhaps China creating semi-authoritarian machines. And in the middle of this world, where the vast majority of people live, these technologies are being exported, instituted by governments and private companies. And so we're creating this wealth of visual information. And to me, the kind of the crux of it lies is this is not, as I said, it's not a neutral technology, but it is using actors, state and non-state actors, are using these technologies more and more to codify our identity. On the corporate side, are you a user or not? Are you a subscriber or not? And as we scale up and see the integrated systems, with self-driving cars, perhaps in the near future, being able to serve custom advertisements to us, because an Uber three cars ago was another Uber that spotted us and realized that we were a customer, but we haven't used their service in a while, so maybe this is a good opportunity to serve us an ad. Ads are maybe a bit innocuous, it's not the biggest thing, but as we see trends going forward, what does it mean when the encapsulation of our identity through our image can then be used to nudge our, not consumption decisions, but perhaps our voting decisions, our decisions of how similar someone is to me politically. And as we're seeing a world that seems to be too, it seems that the trends are going towards, the polarization of ideas, that it's easy to see how these sort of technologies, on top of the already social media platforms that we have, can lead to not only more inequality, but less understanding. And to me, this is one of the fundamental paradoxes of technology. Yes, it can be a tool for us to be able to have better access, to be able to have better communication, but at the same time, it is a mechanism of control. And so I would encourage everyone to think about this going forward. I think in the digital rights community and advocacy activist scenes that we're focused often on addressing the problems of today. But there are already 5-year plans mapped out by companies, 10-year plans mapped out by governments about what technology will look like in the future. And so I think it's important for us to not just try to address the problems of today, but map out the eventualities and potentialities of tomorrow and understand what is the work that we're doing now, how does that impact the future, and how can we, in some cases, get ahead of what companies and countries are doing, because what we're talking about really is building a technology framework that may be with humanity for as long as humanity is here. And these baseline test data sets of recorded images are not going away, and the dynamic aspect of them means that just because they mean something today does not mean they mean something tomorrow. I think that's all I have. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Wee Pyu Min. I am from Myanmar, or also known as Burma. I work for the Myanmar Center for Responsible Business, which is a Yangon-based organization working to promote responsible business practice in all different sectors in Myanmar. So ICT is one of our focus areas. So is it because Myanmar is currently experiencing one of the fastest market for data connectivity. At the same time, we are in the early stage of the transitions to democracy. So many of you might have remember that exactly 1 year of this time, We just got a first newly elected democratic government for the first time in many years. So, I mean, our struggles, our long struggles for the human rights, our long struggles for democracy has been well documented in the international news as well. So, I mean, many of us are kind of like naive enough, you know. So by this time, you know, we might have a positive of good stories to be shared with you. But unfortunately, that's not the case, not yet. So I'm like, basically I'm here to talk about the challenges we are still facing, especially in the digital rights issues, like dealing with these ICT related issues in Myanmar. So right now, at currently, we are having a number of like increasing number of arrests, and also the growing use of defamation provisions to arrest journalists and human rights defenders and etc. on these like around these like defamation issues, and also we still have a problem of the continued problem of this hate speech as well. And also at the same time, you know, we are still in an early stage of the transition period, right? But at the same time, we still have a kind of like an absolute or in some cases, you know, almost absent of this legal framework around these, particularly around these ICT issues to have safeguards around these human rights and issues. So basically, that's, we are still in that stage. So and our center, MCRB, we conduct a research basically to be able to study the impacts of the ICT sector, both online issues and offline issues on the human rights, general human rights issues. So we did a research that was in late 2014, and also we published the report in the September 2015. So and I can show you this is the full report. So basically it's we touch on all these like SOROP issues, online issues, freedom of expressions, privacy, lawful interception issue, and also offline issues is all about related to the issues of the network rollout plan, like land issues, like health and safety issues around this issue. So in our research, what we find about is one thing is this like gaps in these legal frameworks eventually could have a potential, you know, impacts on these the human rights issues. So we have already started seeing it. For example, you know, when we look at these existing legal framework, domestic ICT related legal framework, we already seen about it. You know, that the laws, existing laws, kind of lack of these, like, doesn't in line with the international standards, doesn't really have adequate safeguards around these human rights issues. And also, we still have a number of legislated around these, like, a data protection issue, the surveillance and, you know, interception issues, and also even the hate speech as well. So those are still the issues. So when right now, I mean, when we look at this like existing legal framework, so we have already all these like different organization has been already mentioned about it. Okay, these are the areas, you know, legislations need to be improved, and we need more legislation and etc. But the new government, the new democratically elected government, hasn't done literally nothing yet to improve this situation yet. So that is kind of like a little bit depressing, and also sometimes in some sense it also we a little bit frustrating about these issues as well. So and also in some cases it even get worse. So because for example this this is notorious case, it's a 66D of the telecommunications law. It's criminalized defamation for the Facebook post. So we have been already started. But the country right now, the ICT issue is because we are very new to the ICT. So we just started the reform in this telecommunications sector in 2013 with the adoption of the telecommunications law. And then with this telecommunications law, government gave it out two licenses to the foreign operators. So we, in addition to the state-owned operators, we have now currently three operators. So they start operating in 2014. So by the end of we already start seeing this is like a very fast growth of teleconnectivity. At the end of 2013, this mobile penetration in Myanmar, mobile means like a telecommunications, it is less than 10% of the population. And within 2 years, now we are reaching to almost 80%. So that is so fast. And also people often say that Myanmar is the country from no phone to the smartphone. So now over 78% of the mobile users are the smartphone users. So literally, I mean, we are experienced about it, no internet at all whatsoever, and to dryly people have been getting all these like different applications, different exposed to different things and etc. So and also, I mean, when we especially like when we go to these outside Yangon, and then when you meet people and then you ask about it, do you use internet? They might say that, oh yes. And then which kinds of website you usually check or usually look, they will only say it about Facebook. So Facebook is the most popular medium of communications in Myanmar. So right now, about like 10 million active monthly users of Facebook in Myanmar. That's me 20% of the population. So this is the other side. Because we really came from this totally no connection whatsoever to the right away the smartphone. So we have the issues of the digital literacy around these issues. So Land Asia recently published a survey result. It said that only 25% of the men of mobile users know how to search information by themselves online. And then only 19% of the women knows how to search information online by themselves. So this is like a digital literacy issue is also another big gap in Myanmar. So people are even sometimes, you know, like a majority of the people of Facebook user in the outside Yangon, they are like definitely somebody set up their Facebook account. So they don't even know their password. Every time they change the phone and they set up a new account. So sometimes like I grew up in a village and often, you know, I got the relatives and friends and etc. Even though they are already in my friend list, they keep like you know. Next day, a couple of months after, I got another like a new you know Facebook request and etc. I was like, oh, they are already in the. So when I checked that, oh, you are already in my friends list. Why I'm? And then they said, oh, we changed the phone. And because they don't know the password, and they don't even know how to set up the Facebook. Somebody set up the Facebook for them. So if they got the new phone, they got it. So those like a those privacy issue, data privacy issues, not just about the legal, lack of the legal framework, and also we have a lot like around these like digital literacy, digital skills issues is also a problem currently right now. So when we look at this, currently we have this like a growing number of arrests and this 66D of the telecommunications, a number of prominent journalists, politicians, and human rights defenders has been sued for their Facebook post. Defaming other. That's me even including me post about like some they already behind several cases like people posted about like this Photoshop picture of Aung San Suu Kyi or the someone went take the picture or step in the picture of the military commander in chief and posted it on Facebook and they got sued for the defamation. So it's already had been and of the problem is not just people from one person to another person suing each other, but it is now like even the leaders of the NND party. For example, right now the Yangon chief minister has already sued the publisher and journalist for defamation by using the 66D of telecommunication. And also Aung San Suu Kyi, right-wing person U Win Tae also have sued by using this provision to a journalist in in Moya region. So we have already not just like a citizen from one citizen to another, even the politicians and leaders are using this clause to sue the person who is talking bad things about them on Facebook. So it has been 30 years. So we are now like, people often say that, you know, oh yeah, in the conference, oh yeah, I can talk about this issue, but it is on Facebook or it is online, I won't say that. People are already start censoring themselves. And also when we look at these cases, you know, we have already now, since the law was adopted in 2013, late 2013, there are already recorded, you know, prominent cases which involve these prominent journalists, human rights, and politicians. It's already have 57 cases. And out of 57 cases, 47 are happened in the first year of this democratically elected government. That is alarming for us. And then when we look at these cases, you can bail out, you know, if the cases is not involved with these prominent politician, but if the involved with the Aung San Suu Kyi or this military commander in chief Min Aung Hlaing or even the same leaders of the NLD party, you cannot even bail out the person. So that's also another issue. And then recently earlier this month we got the government adopted a new law. It's called Citizens Privacy and Security Protection Bill. So particular, is this mainly talk about privacy issues and to cover about these protections. But the thing is, so we have already found a number of concerns on this law. First, this law is not well consulted. Since the beginning, since the drafting stage, we have MCRB, our organization, and also a number of different organizations has been sending recommendations to the government, to the parliament. Okay, there are a number of flaws, you know, but they just ignore. And then when we look at this, after this law was passed, when we look at about it, lacks these safeguards around this human rights issue. And also doesn't really talk about these digital protection issues as well. Even though it's talk about privacy and et cetera, they mainly just only talk about covers about physical protections, physical privacy, police searching your home, police entering into your house, and et cetera. That's it. And also, the issue is, you know, the problem is in this law. Another problem in this law is also it has this kind of gave the big permission. You know, if it is not accordant with the law, the president or anybody from the union level government can issue a permission and get all these requested data from the operators and etc. So doesn't really have any rights respecting mechanism or these interception issue, how to protect these data and et cetera around these issues. That is that also. But and then the hate speech issue as well. So currently, Ministry of Religious and Culture, they have been drafting a bill on the hate speech. So we understand about the behind the reasoning of using the Ministry of Culture, putting the Ministry of Culture and Religious Affairs. Of course, majority of the hate speech talking on the online are targeting to the minority Muslims, but at the same time, you know, there are others vulnerable groups like women, children, you know, disabled groups. So that's why we are concerned about it. If the Ministry of Culture and Religious Affairs, this law might be only looking at from the perspective of the religious side of view, might not be covered from these different other perspectives. And yesterday morning, I attended a number of sessions and speakers talking about it, how this to regulate hate speech and how. Hate speech should be regulated. This is still such a debate, and also it's a very sensitive and very complicated matter. Before I came here, when I reached out to the Ministry of Culture and Religious Affairs, what is going on with this draft law? And they said, we have already done our part. We already sent it to the Attorney General Office, and no public consultation has ever done at all. So we are concerned about it, those issues. So we are still some of these negative things, negative impacts have already done in terms of telecommunications law and privacy bill. But in other areas, kind of like we are still in the early stage. So that's why I think we stay hope, we have a stay opportunity, you know, to make it right since the very beginning. So we really want this is the why I am here, to able to share our frustration. At the same time, to be able to learn from all these different all of you as well. So thank you so much.
Hello everyone, my name is Japleen Pasricha and I'm from India. I run a digital media platform called Feminism in India. And I will be speaking today on women in Wikipedia and how to organize Wikipedia edithons to reduce the gender gap. But before I start my talk, I have a short video to show. Can you play the video now?
Globally, only 9% of Wikipedia editors are women. And in India, the statistic is even worse. Only 3% of Indian Wikipedia editors are women.
The gap is not just quantitative, but also qualitative. The famous example from a New York Times article a few years ago is that articles on topics generally associated with girls, like friendship bracelets, are only a few paragraphs long, while topics that are typically associated with boys, like toy soldiers or baseball cards, have multi-page entries with chronological lists and so on.
To reduce the gender gap on Wikipedia, we have been doing these edithons since last year.
First time in an editathon, I got to learn a lot about making Wikipedia pages, especially for Indian women scientists, and it was inspiring.
First time, and it was fun to know about women scientists from India and to write about them.
Basically, I feel that it was a very productive day and would love to
and
come back here again.
And it was fun too.
Yeah. Enjoyed a lot. Yeah. Truly.
Thank you. Well, that was mostly my lightning talk. I don't really have to talk after this, but I will still give a short description of what we do and how other organizations can replicate this effort. So the first, you know, general question is, why choose Wikipedia? Wikipedia is the most, sought after first-hand platform where we go for information. It is the most popular website for any kind of basic information that we click. So it is then extremely important to have a gender balance on Wikipedia, both in terms of editors as well as content. And in 2011, Wikipedia themselves conducted a study where they found out that only 9% of Wikipedia editors are women globally. This is the global stat. And in India, it's just 3%. The highest is in US, which is about 20% of editors are women. And yeah, India and some other countries are the lowest, which have like 1% to 2%. So, as also we saw in the video, it just does not reflect in the number of Wikipedia editors, but also then the content on how, because Wikipedia is a crowdsourced platform and it's a volunteer-run platform, so what we write and how we write about it then also reflects on who is writing. To reduce the gender gap on Wikipedia, we started these day-long editathons with collaborating with other social justice organizations in India, specifically New Delhi. I'm from New Delhi. And what we do is we choose a topic and we can choose any topic. So for the first one, we chose Indian women poets and authors. We cull out a list of poets and authors who either do not have any kind of representation on Wikipedia or have stub pages, which are very short pages. And then we make a list out of all these people. And then we make an event. So we use Facebook and other social media platforms, Twitter, Instagram, etc., to disseminate the information about our event. We, you know, book a space, have refreshments, because this is a day-long event, so people will also require to freshen up, and yeah, you have to feed them. And yeah, and then we have this particular rule, because we realize that always tech related events are very male dominated, and we didn't want that to happen in our Wikipedia marathon, because that was just not the point. If there aren't women coming up to the event, then we will not be able to increase the number of Wikipedia women editors on Wikipedia. So we have this rule that if a guy wants to come to the event, they have to be a plus one to one of the women coming. So if you want to come, you have to bring a woman along, or if a woman is coming, they can bring a guy along, but you have to have a plus one with you. You can't just come on your own. This increases the participation of women as compared to men. So most of our marathons have a 70-30 or 60-40 participation where there are more women and less men. And as you saw in the video, most of the people who come to our marathons, they are newbies. They have never edited on Wikipedia. They come from a very non-tech background. So these marathons not just aim at producing content at the end of the day, but they also teach new skill to people who have never edited Wikipedia. And actually, editing on Wikipedia is less of a tech skill and more of a research skill, to be honest. You really have to, you know, say, tell them again and again that everything that you write on Wikipedia needs to be sourced. You cannot just write information that you know from your head if you know that person personally or whom you're editing. So, you know, doing a one-hour orientation before we start the marathon on what are the rules of Wikipedia on neutrality and sourcing, and what kind of sources can be used, what kind of blogs can be used, newspapers, books, etc. And then how to edit. So that then comes the tech part. And thankfully, Wikipedia, a couple of years back, introduced the visual editor, which is much easier for people who are not coders, because the earlier editor was the HTML editor and wasn't really, you know, user-friendly for people who are not used to having a HTML space to write and code. So now, since Wikipedia has the visual editor, it actually becomes easier for non-tech people to write and edit on Wikipedia. And we have been doing various marathons. We choose a topic every month. We try to do that monthly, one Saturday a month. And since, you know, India being a multilingual country, we want to not just close the gender gap on Wikipedia, but also cut linguistic barriers. So although majorly we edit in English, which is also our official language, but we try to edit in other regional languages of India. So we have till we collaborate with other Wikipedia language groups in India. So there's Punjabi Wikimedians, there's Malayalam Wikimedians, and we ask them to come and bring their participants so that it's a mix of feminists and women and you know, Wikimedians who edit in their own languages, Punjabi, Malayalam, Hindi, et cetera, So now we, in our last marathon, we were editing in four languages because we were also collaborating with the Swedish embassy in New Delhi. And we had a parallel event with the embassy where they were organizing an event in Sweden with Wikimedia Sweden. So we were actually editing in English, Sweden, Punjabi, and Malayalam. And yeah, so as I said, it's a great thing to replicate. It's very easy. You do, and Wikipedia really loves people who do such marathons. You do not need permission as such. We are not in touch with Wikipedia or Wikimedia Foundation at all. And it's you can just do this event anytime and anywhere. And it's really easy to organize. It's a productive event, because at the end of the day, you have articles. At least one person will finish one article, so you will have a list of articles that you have created at the end of the day. Okay, thank you.
Are there any questions or comments to the presentation? The presentations? Yeah.
My question is to you about Wikipedia. We tried to do some of the editons in Egypt in the Arabic Wikipedia, but actually the admins of the Arabic Wikipedia are very strict, so it's usually very disappointing for people to try and research some document, some topic, and prepare an article on it, and then the next day they come and find that it's deleted.
Yes.
So I'm wondering if you face something like this, and if it's easier on the English Wikipedia.
Yeah, that has happened a couple of times, especially because most of the participants are new and they don't know what kind of sources are used. And also, although Wikipedia has rules, these are not laws that can't be negotiated. So we have a open, you know, attitude towards Wikipedia rules. So sometimes we do use sources that, according to Wikipedia rules, are not allowed, but we feel that it is an important source. And then it's actually a battle out on the talk page. You have to, you know, present your case to the senior editors who have been editing since a long time. And, you know, then there's this whole negotiation about, oh, I am on Wikipedia since such a long time, and you just came today and edited an article, and now, you know, this is problematic and that is problematic. So, but it's a negotiation thing. It's not exactly something that they can just chuck you out, because there's no one who, you know, runs Wikipedia. It's a crowdsourced, volunteer-run platform. So it's as much yours as mine, but it's just a case of negotiation that you have to do sometimes, yeah.
Sometimes it's very hard for
it
new,
is. I, yeah,
new
I
authors
know.
To get them into which that is, conflict in
which
the
is
community.
Why, after having 3 editathons just among the feminist circle, we collaborated with the Wikimedian groups who are sensitive, and so whenever an argument that like that comes up, I just push them forward. I said, you take it. I'm
Thank you.
I have a question for Misha.
Misha.
Okay. In terms of, you talked about the strategic litigation at the end of your talk. Is that really the first time you've seen online activists take a case? And can you say just a little more about where it is? Is it just started?
Yeah, because the cybercrime law in the Philippines is fairly new. One of the arguments against it is it's actually redundant because there's existing libel. It's a comprehensive law, but one part that's being used here is the libel, online threats, and grave threats provision. And that already exists in the penal code, which is why we're against having sort of a redundant cybercrime law. But what that cybercrime law does is it actually holds harsher penalties for offenders. And so when you litigate under that law, it's actually more powerful. And that law has been in effect in the past few years. One of the first cases that it was used for was actually against a human rights defender for speaking up against a mining company, I believe. So yeah, so it's a fairly new sort of law to use, and even the digital rights lawyers are saying, even though we have problems with it, but it's the law and we have to litigate under the law that already exists. So the case that I talked about was filed in around, I think, May of last year. It happened around the elections in the Philippines. So right now it's still actually undergoing investigation. So it's very, very, the justice system in the Philippines is very slow, as some people may know. But that's why we call it the strategic litigation. Just the act of filing the case can have a huge effect.
So I had a question on Myanmar, and I think it's interesting that in the area of business and human rights, what one hears a lot about is land, environment, and sort of labor concerns with incoming investment. So I wonder if you could talk a bit about some of the challenges or the ways in which working in ICT has been more difficult or easier, maybe, because it's not as much of a focus for a lot of, I guess, media reports and coverage of the country.
Yes, that's true. Like land issues here at lot, like the even safeties and other things are like, I mean, related to this like investment coming in. And but ICT is still very new, and also like I can say about it like not just the user and also the media as well. You know, the impacts of the ICT. I mean, and also sometimes you know it's also a little bit difficult to see. You know, if it is not about related to the laws and etc. So people haven't really discussed about this issue yet, so you don't really see much in the media. So that's this issue. But the thing is, still, you know, we have already start seeing these like alarming impacts because of that's what both. I mean, not just the lack of the legal framework, and also at the same time, you know, the user awareness around these issues are also still a very relatively, you know, low compared to the other countries and etc. So yes, that's true.
I wanted to ask Matthew about the issue of informed consent and the platforms around which a lot of user data is collected, and in light with like takeovers. So like if I trust a company, like just a simple startup that is, you know, all cool and doing good stuff, my terms of giving that data are captured by my idea or the extent to which I know and trust that company. But when they are, say, like being bought up by maybe another company that probably I don't respect, I may feel a bit like if I knew I was dealing with that company in the first place, or I would deal with that company in the first place, this much data will not pass through that device to that platform. Now, the users or people who you know, have handed over this critical personal identifying data to those platforms don't have a word on what will happen to their data should they have like a takeover or they have been bought. Should they, from your conversation, I felt like maybe you have some insight into how probably terms of references of time, whatever TOC can be understood from a perspective of user consent when companies are buying over. Like people should be given like a month, like in the next 1 month, this company has expressed interest to take over our company. If you feel that this amount of data for, you know, like, you know, you have this time to exit before we are bought. But then I would imagine that is their value proposition for the takeover. What do you think from your experience, how such a thing can be handled?
I don't have a great answer for that, but I am working on a model at the moment. I've been really interested in kind of post facto data changes under three models. One is mergers and acquisitions. We're seeing Yahoo right now probably being bought by Verizon. Yahoo has something like a billion global like users, and so this is massive. Going back a decade, I had a Yahoo email address. I don't know, when it was my first email address. And so somehow, like, now a company is going to have, you know, be able to maybe even mine, you know, even text mine, my emails, you know, my first email address. So I think that there's the mergers and acquisitions, which is its own category. Then there's the unilateral data policy change by a company. When Facebook or Google says, surprise, here's our new policy, click yes to continue. This is another model. And then also governments. We've seen the U.S., the Dreamers Act, which were undocumented, mostly people of Mexican origin in the U.S., that had come to the U.S. when they were young. The Obama administration had said, okay, we're going to put a line on some documents, especially medical documents, but we want you to check the box if you are one of these Dreamers. You're a protected class now, not a proper protected class, but you're going to be okay. But then now the Trump administration has come in and is actually using this information to I don't know if anybody's been deported under it, but they've stripped away the protections that the Obama administration had put forward. So, and to me, there's actually kind of three different cases that I'm working with. I'm sure there's many other things, but the mergers and acquisition, this is one case. Companies just unilaterally saying, oh, you know, remix our data policy, and then governments also be using their powers as state to be able to compel companies to hand over data that wasn't in the original kind of user consent. So I don't have an answer, you know, of that, but it's something that I am, you know, I have been thinking about lately, and it's a very big issue. It's the longevity of these things. If we can't trust companies, or we can't trust our service providers to always have our back, you know, if they're going to get bought up and everything we've put into these systems is not subject to the same privacy regulations as we assumed that it would be when we use the platform, it is quite problematic. So that's something I'm thinking about, but I unfortunately do not have answers for yet.
Following a bit on from that, Matthew, in terms of thinking about remedies for users, have you done any thinking about different models for the way users could actually access remedy that doesn't rely on courts that can take years and years and years?
Ooh, I mean, that's, I will say that I don't think it's practical for, or I a lot of people, I guess, you know, there's these conversations on Twitter and saying, oh, just leave the platform if you're not happy, if you don't feel, but as you said, that a lot of the, I mean, this explosion of people coming onto Facebook that feel that's the internet in Myanmar and other places. So if we're looking at the global scale, what may work in America in a privileged situation is not globally applicable. And I think that solutions should be, I think that any things we put forward should be global solution oriented. That companies, if they're not getting this data in the West, then they're gonna go other places and still be able to mine data. So. I think that what it comes down to, saying earlier, that if we are able to fortify the idea of sovereignty, of digital sovereignty, of self in the world, if we're hit, you know, by a fist, you know, we can take punitive action, but we don't have that same ability to take action against companies, and especially as individuals, and especially if we're having to arbitrate amongst five different parties, you know, that have a certain type of data on us, and so. I think that what is kind of coming in my mind, the swirl is somehow increasing the capacity for individual sovereignty in the digital space, much, you know, like it has throughout history existed in the real world space. But even with location tracking data, I mean, yeah, what is a location? What power do I have over that? And if I'm left to arbitrate, you know, or you know, with five different, with its distributed governance framework, I think that it's too burdensome on the user, and to come up with a comprehensive strategy that addresses this on a global scale, we need to start thinking about kind of the unified, unitary, sovereign digital self.
Are there any more questions or comments? In that case, we conclude our lightning talks today. Thank you very much. Please help me thank the speakers.